Here with Adam Apicella. He is the what are you? What's your title here? You're like a big shot, right?
I do a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is our first interview. I'm excited. You've never agreed to interview me through all of StarCraft II, and our first Dota 2 event, you're just like,
oh man.
Like, sure, I'll do an interview. So, why now?
You've been begging for like 5 years. It was a pity party.
Oh, come on. I wasn't begging. I just had to get you in before the Ohio State-Michigan game next week because...
Well, my exclusive interview with Wax Angel coming up, my buddy.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we'll get that one next, maybe. How's the event going for you guys? Going well?
It's going really well. Yeah, I mean, attendance, we didn't pass Anaheim, but it'll be our second largest event ever in terms of live event
and
attendance.
Only 2 games?
Only 2 games.
Okay. Which one do you like more?
Which game do I like more?
Yeah.
I like both of my children equally.
Very PR answer, but if you had to pick one, do you like COD? I know you're like an old school shooter guy. You can say that.
No, you know, actually, I played a lot of Warcraft, so, and I played a lot of the Halo 1, but not so much of the later Halos, so... If I had to pick one, if like one of the top teams is playing Call of Duty, like Optic or Complexity, they're fun to watch, but in terms of just sitting down and watching something for hours, I'd probably pick Dota to watch.
Have you played?
I played for one night, and it was so daunting.
Which hero did you pick? You look like an axe kind of hero guy.
I was the knight.
Night Stalker?
No, like the Dragon Knight.
Dragon Knight. Yeah, that makes sense. Pretty good hero too.
Yeah, I was playing with some friends and they were teaching me, so enough that I could understand when I watch it.
What's your favorite team out here?
I always like when the teams that don't have a lot of you know, like there's a lot of tournaments going on right now where it's like we try to watch all of them to see what everyone else is doing and, you know, try to learn stuff from other events, and it seems like the Alliance and Na'Vi and all these guys play each other quite a bit. So for me it's really exciting when you see like DK come over and they get to play teams that you don't necessarily see on a regular basis. So I think it's really intriguing for me to see the Chinese teams come over, and also my pick Sigma.
You're the one that decided Sigma, and I bet you got a lot of hate mail from a lot of Dota community members wanting you to invite someone else, and it looks like someone was right. This is your time to gloat and say I told you so. So here, you can have it.
I mean, do I really need to say anything? I mean, they're what, 4-1, 5-1?
Yeah, they're so. Gonna advance for sure, I think.
I think they're in for sure. It's actually crazy because Na'Vi and Alliance are going to play, and whoever loses is out. Mm-hmm. So I don't think anybody would have called that.
Yeah, crazy. You know what people are going to flame you for? The format. That's what they're going to blame you for. They're going to find a way. Best of one. They're going to be like, it should be at least best of two. That's what they're going to say.
Best of two? You mean 2 games?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's how a lot of the formats are, 2 games, so that they get first pick, second pick, you know, that
I
kind
mean,
of thing.
Yeah, if we were split over 2 pools and it was less of a drain on the players, then I could see that. But having them play even 2 games with that many games, it just, I think going into Sunday, they would have been exhausted. And, you know, when you have 45 players coming in and from all around the world and their all schedules are different and their travel's delayed and, you know, Friday's always hectic, you know, you kind of have to have a little bit of, not sympathy, but, like, empathy for, like, what the players go through to get here and, like, the long days they have. So I agree the format probably could have been 2 games, but I don't think the players probably would have agreed in terms of fatigue and just mental well-being.
I think they like the best of three finals, right? I think they like that.
Some do. I mean, I haven't heard much feedback from players. I know the fans aren't very happy.
Yeah, that they want best of five, but yes. The players, I think they like best of three.
So, I mean, that's definitely something we're going to look at after we have some data from a real event, and we look at the schedule and the cadence of everything, and whether we over-budgeted or under-budgeted for match times, but... we definitely want to look at a best of five grand finals.
And how have the bundle sales been going?
We've increased prizes to, I think we're almost at 136,000. So we've done nearly $90,000 in sales.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, pretty awesome. Thank you.
You like? You're gonna be designing more MLG?
Yeah, I mean, we started working on our own stuff in house in August, September, and I think we underestimated like the quality that you need, like the amount of detail work that goes into it. And I said this in one of the interviews, but if you look at even the top guys on the market now, or back when they first started to now, their work is like exponentially increased in terms of quality. And the guy we have working on it, a local artist actually from Columbus, I met actually through Reddit. he's done a great job. But it's just there's a lot of stuff when you're on the Steam shop and you're going through that, using that canvas to create IP. A lot of hiccups came up where it's like something didn't work right.
It's a slow kind of process. You gotta iterate a lot of times.
So we didn't want to release something that we didn't feel was up to the quality that we wanted the fans to have. And, you know, Valve agreed, and they really just helped us get in contact with some of the artists. So I think in the future we're going to roll out more stuff that we've been working on when it's ready. But we'll definitely continue to work with the artists that we've been talking to, too, like TV Dodo and Danadim and those guys.
Well, we have some suggestions from the TL forums.
Oh, boy, here we go.
They want a no-scope sniper rifle.
Yep. We had a Sneaky Beaver. Valve said no.
No, why not?
They said it was not in the lore. We had a Sneaky Beaver with a musket. And he did a 360 no scope, and they said it's not happening.
Well, you know, you need like a courier that like carries dumbbells and goes to the gym.
Oh boy, here we go.
Gotta get that one.
You said you were not going to troll me in this interview.
I'm not trolling you. It's a serious question. You clearly been working out. It's your best lift.
You're such an asshole.
This is what we wanted. Before the interview, he was like, we need to talk about lifting. That's what he said.
Oh, man.
that's what we're all here for. This is the content that the Dota 2 community wants. They want, you know, lifting tips.
I'm just, you know, I've been talking to Demon a lot about, Demon, you know, some programs. Yeah. And
were you surprised that he wasn't as jacked as you thought he would be?
No, he was pretty much right on what I expected.
Okay. And you're trying to get him into an MLG though. Eventually, he's gotta make it to one.
I do feel bad for the kid.
Not his fault, you know.
Yeah, not his fault. Which part?
not his fault. The first team was his fault. The second team wasn't.
No,
his
that
fault.
was unfortunate.
So only 50% of the disqualifications.
He's been. We talk a lot, like, on Skype, and, you know, he's actually given me a lot of advice with, like, what we should do with our Dota, you know, with our tournaments and everything, and he's actually been very polite and professional with me behind the scenes. I know that he feels bad about the first DQ, and, you know, in hindsight, if he could go back, he'd do it different. So I feel bad for him about just the whole road to this event, and just seeing him here and seeing him, like, you could tell he wants to get back and play.
MLG.
Yeah,
hashtag
MLG.
I mean, you
dedication.
Understand, you know, missing stuff for the gym. It's happened once or twice before to you. So, you know, sometimes it happens.
Gotta get them workouts in, man.
I know. Yeah. It's, I'll ask you for tips. I'll go with you next time. We'll go to the gym.
Me, you, and Wax Angel. And Rich.
Wax Angel. Right? Wax Angel. Yes. Maybe. Yeah, we'll see about that one. I don't know if that'll happen. But it'll be a group effort. You know, MLG, you guys have been getting a lot of good community goodwill. From the community, but you've also been getting a lot of, you know, you get a lot of responses from the community too.
Yeah.
I don't think there's been a major kind of like thing yet where people have been like, you know, getting mad, like nothing like the Dire Tide or anything like that. You scared of when that happens, or you think that maybe if we just
No, I mean, I'll say it's when I think this community as a whole, just not just Dota, any game. I feel like we live in the moment when something happens, and it's like we all blow it out of proportion. Whether it's the person that's happening to, we MLG will react over the top. And I feel like the community at the same time will also explode, and they get behind something and it just snowballs. So, I think the lesson that I've learned is that people just want whether you're apologizing or admitting a mistake or trying to solve something, they just want to hear from you. And also, just not like going and hiding and like not overreacting. You don't want to hide. So what I've done is I've done a lot of listening. And I've done a lot of like, even when it's bad, try to respond. And, you know, I think we could have done a lot better job of that with StarCraft. I feel like at the beginning of that relationship, we were very communicative. And then, you know, somewhere along the way, we stopped responding on Reddit or, you know, just became a little bit too busy for the community. And that's as horrible as that sounds. It's the truth. And, you know, I think the community is the most important thing, and you need to like interface with them, or else they're going to make their own story for you. Because if you don't go out and speak your side, they're just going to put words in your mouth and make assumptions.
Yeah. Well, we're luckily we cover two games, so I was able to come to this one.
You just added League of Legends on your site. You only cover two?
I don't think we have
League
of Legends.
It's on your streaming thing,
right
now. Though.
It is. We can't ignore the numbers.
So you just want them to come to your site. And,
yes,
but you don't
that's
want to actually
exactly
do
right.
Okay, got it.
But you know how it is. You know, can't ignore those league numbers. Get that riot money. That's the goal, right? But you know that this event it seems to be quite successful thus far. You have a huge plan for 2014. Culminates in June. Do you feel like that? Like that's going to be like the probably the last huge tournament right before TI. Was that the goal of it? Or
so I guess DreamHack will be before us. Like this year they go after us. So Q2 of next year it'll be DreamHack summer.
Yeah, DreamHack summer is usually middle of June.
Yeah, because we moved our dates. So yeah.
Yeah, you guys were on the same date for a while.
For like 3 days.
That was like fun. It was fun stuff.
Yeah. We solved it.
Yeah.
We fixed it.
It's good.
What's the question?
What's the end goal? You want to build up the North American scene? I think a lot of people, they see MLG and they're like, MLG switches games a lot. Mm-hmm. So like, it's like, they're scared, you know, like MLG is going to come in, they're going to do all the stuff for Dota, and then suddenly, like, maybe something will happen and they'll just drop the game. Like, that's what the people are scared about, you know? So what can you say towards that to kind of, like, reassure people about so that things don't go that way?
So, I mean, there's nothing I can say in terms of reassurance. I mean, we need to assess our plans that we've announced. We've already announced that we're going to change what we, like, our January to June plans. Mm-hmm. Like, June's still there. It's, like, this big event. But leading up, we had this league play and all the stuff that was North America focused, and we're still going to have a North American focus, but this is before the DreamHack announcement and other leagues, and it seems like there's a league every night. Almost like every night there's 3 hours. Like you go from
there's
one
more.
League
yeah.
to the next
yeah.
to the next.
It's like just it's even more saturation than StarCraft was. Like,
it definitely is, and I feel like that's something we're all going to need to be cautious of. Not only as operators, but as the players themselves, is we need to make sure that those top matches remain special, because if every night those guys are playing, it's going to become
that's what happens these days. Those same top eight teams play over and over every single night.
Yep,
which is it's good for the fans, but for overall it's like a lot of saturation. You don't have like if you had NFL teams or whatever, if it was possible to play every night, I think that would dilute the product a lot.
Yep. So. And that's another thing too with esports, there is no off season, like because we all have our own different agendas, our own businesses, so it's basically 12 months a year someone's running an event with these guys. So all that being said, we still want to focus on North America. We do feel though that we should have some type of international star power involved in some way, but more of a North American focus. But we're talking about our plans internally, what we want to do, but we don't want to do something that everyone else is doing. We want to fill a need or something that the fans want. And I feel like another league with the same teams or just more North American teams isn't really going to move the needle in terms of what people want.
Yeah, I think that's right. That's a good decision.
So, I mean, hopefully we'll have some details to announce after this event in December, early January, but we're talking to Join Dota, we're talking to Beyond the Summit, we're talking to all these guys about, hey, if you were us, what would you do? And like, what would the fans appreciate? And I just don't think, again, that league play like everyone else is doing is what we want to do.
You know what you should do?
Oh, well, here we go.
You should bring in the Korean teams.
Mm-hmm.
And then have them do show matches against the top North American and European teams. You got to get that in while we can still win. Because, right now, did you watch Nexon?
Yeah.
The Korean teams got stomped.
Did they?
Yeah, by a lot. It wasn't even close. So they're still young. They're not even close yet.
So beat them while we can?
Yeah, you got to get them in, get the show matches in before, they start training.
Yeah.
So before, you got about a good 1-2 years maybe before StarCraft happens all over again. So let's get you got to cash in while we can. Cash our chips in.
That's a great plan.
Yeah. You saw the video, right? The video of the stick figure guy.
Mm-mm.
No, you haven't seen it?
No.
We'll put a link into the video. Basically, it's this like little stick figure guy, and it's all in like human-made sound effects.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like he gets off a plane, and he's like a guy with a Korean face, and he just runs up, and he grabs money from someone and an MLG trophy, and he runs back on the plane, and it just takes off.
I had to see that.
Yeah, it's the truth is what it is in certain games, but this one seems to be a lot more, it's harder to break in terms of, because it's like you need good practice to become a great team.
Is this Matt Weber?
Yeah, this is him.
Is this Hayoka?
Yeah, it is.
Why don't you get to do interviews ever?
Sometimes I do.
He did BlizzCon interviews. What?
It's on our front page right now.
Yeah, come on.
You don't read the camera side.
Huh?
Yeah. Can we call in a sub? I don't want him interviewing me anymore.
we'll switch it up next time, maybe.
Right.
No, you're out.
Hey, how you doing?
Great.
How come you removed me on Skype? That's my first question.
What do I do?
Do you remember that? We were friends on Skype, and now we're not.
I didn't delete you.
Yeah, you did. Yeah. The other day, I was like, oh, I'm gonna send Adam a message. Tell him I think he's been doing a good job. So sad.
I think I pruned my list. And you might have been one of the cuts.
You decided you were just done with me, huh? That's what it is?
Remember
my name somehow.
My
what
list
was that?
Is Sundance, Mike, Rich from TL.
Right.
And Wax Angel. So I got four people on my list. So
that sucks. Yeah. Fifth string.
Yeah, you didn't even make the cut.
It's awful.
So what we got?
I don't know. I wasn't really preparing, so I'm just kind of doing this
Neither
off the cuff.
Neither was Ken. That was
yeah. We could talk about working out,
so
I guess.
What's your best lift?
What is your best lift?
Yeah, I'm actually curious. What is it?
I'd probably bench.
You bench like 500 pounds?
I wish. No, I can bench. Not anymore. But I've hit 405.
Pretty good. Is that more than Korok?
I see strong.
Yeah.
I don't. I'm trying to get the demon.
I liked how you said hashtag dedication. That was good.
Oh yeah.
So actually, one thing I did notice is that, you know, you're talking about your dedication or your communication with the community. Mm-hmm. That's something you've been trying to do. You've been trying to be more open, and I think that is something you've done a really good job of.
Thank you.
You know, is that something like, you know, your plan is to obviously do that in the future, mm-hmm. right? You're gonna keep.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think. Like I said, I think even if it's not good news, like if it's they're just railing on you, like we've gone in the past and just said, shit, Reddit's killing us today, or we're getting mauled on TL and we've just not responded, that's just the wrong thing to do because it gets worse. So I think what we found is, like with the good news or the bad news, just kind of wade in there and just start talking to people and figure out how to solve it as best as possible. Even if there isn't a solution, just an apology helps. So definitely it opened some eyes, definitely internally in terms of communication strategy and how we should talk to the community, and I think the my interaction with Dota has actually opened a lot of eyes internally with how we should be interfacing with the community.
Yeah, so. It's something you should actually, if you could teach Valve to do that too, it would be really nice, because Valve is really good at what they do, but they're really bad at like saying things. Like for instance, at TI3 when they kicked out LGD because they had roster changes, they didn't say anything at all. They just changed the website and just expected people to like do stuff about it.
Well, I will say from my perspective, Valve's awesome. Like yep. They are super super helpful with everything. And
what? Doesn't sound like company talk at all.
No, I'm being honest. I mean, this
is true. Valve is actually pretty good.
This isn't just bullshit. It's like this event is exponentially better because of all the help they've given us. So it's not like help they don't provide to anybody else, but it's like we ask them for something, or we ask their advice, or how do we do this, or how do we get in contact with this artist, or what should we do from to speed up main stage changeover, everything they've been helpful with. So we've asked them for something custom, they're willing to help us to even program it, but they'll say, you know, if we're going to help you with something, just know that same tool will be available to DreamHack or to ESL or whoever else. They want to create tools for us to be able to succeed, and they want everyone to have access to them. So I think it's a great strategy.
And then I guess I only have like one more question now because I'm kind of running out of things.
Okay.
But
Ken was out of things.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah, I
mean, it was awful.
Yeah.
The worst.
Well, so I do really like that you have the NA League. Like, I think that's kind of cool to create some infrastructure because for NA teams, it's really hard to do anything. You can't like, there's really nowhere to play, and you have to play Europeans, and they're like way better just in general. But you know, it's probably in terms of like running a league, it's not super good for you guys because the teams are not that well known, and it's. It's like a really hard balancing act, I assume.
So it's like the short-term reward business versus the like what's the long tail good for the scene. It's like
right.
With a North American league, viewership won't be stellar.
Exactly, yeah.
Or at least right out of the gate. But long tail, if these guys have something to aspire to in a place where they can play amongst their peers, build confidence. Because winning and getting confidence, putting money in your pocket is literally the best thing to being able to compete on a higher level. It's like... these guys right now, they kind of have nowhere to compete, and then they go to international competition, and those guys are all playing with each other in Europe or in these other tournaments, these leagues, and I feel like there's nothing right now for the North Americans to aspire to. So you're smirking at me. Is that incorrect?
No,
is that good?
I'm just smiling. I'm sorry.
No, it's all right. couldn't tell.
I'm just in a good mood.
It's like a crossfire right here.
I didn't mean to be mean.
Ken keeps smirking every time I say something. I don't know what's going on.
I'm enjoying this. He's very good.
So, short-term reward versus, you know, long-term good for the scene. And, you know, we definitely want to do stuff for North America. I don't know if the plan that we had would have been good enough for us from a viewership perspective, just to be completely honest. And also, I don't think it would have been the platform, with all those factors in mind, to really build up the North American teams how they need to be built up. So I think our current thinking is along the lines of bring in the majority North American players into some type of competition structure, invite a few international teams, and have a rolling season like that. So giving them a chance and opportunity to compete with these guys on a more comfortable level. Because right now, this is the first time Pretty Boy Swag, I think, is in an international competition.
Yeah.
And it's probably pretty jarring for them. You know, it's like, I mean, that's pretty daunting. You look up to, like, Na'Vi and DK and all these guys, and then you're across from them. It's
hard, yeah.
Yeah, it's hard, so.
Yeah, they were actually, their goal, like, coming into this wasn't even to necessarily even win a game.
Yeah.
With the kind of the mentality they were having.
Just get some experience.
Yeah, just, you know, just play well as they could.
And again, I'm no Dota expert, but from talking to all these guys and, like, talking to the BTS guys, if you watch the VOD from the first week of our North American season to the last or even a Full Sail LAN, these guys improved, like, dramatically. Just having that environment to compete in and get better, and hopefully we can provide more opportunities like that for local. So
be nice, yeah.
Yeah.
It's been good so far. So I have been genuinely impressed at how MLG has been handling Dota lately.
Thank you.
I think it's been very good. Do you want to give shout-outs and stuff? Do you want to talk about your company?
No, I think we're good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hashtag MLG.
Hashtag MLG.
I will say that, you know, I think a lot of people don't realize that we're on MLG.tv now instead of embedding elsewhere or being on other platforms. So if you do want to watch our streams in English, we'll be on MLG.tv all weekend. And we have our foreign language streams are on Twitch, so we're... Yeah.
Sounds good?
Yeah.
All right, well.
That was a really horrible ending to this interview.
No, I got to do the outro still.
Go Blue. Yeah.
I got to talk to, you know.
You lost.
You got to check out our other interviews. Be sure to follow us on Twitter and Facebook and other things, I guess. Subscribe to the YouTube. It's all Team LiquidNet. There you go. Thank you.
Great job.